And that is why we are running on a program of what we call democratic socialism, okay? Democratic in the sense that we are really for a full participation in the political system, and socialism in the sense, you know, that the economy should benefit, you know, most of the people, all of the people, and not just a few. And I think our comprehensive program, we have 13 points in our comprehensive program that addresses things from the political system, political change, to the economic system, the importance of real change in the economic system, to environmental change, you know, how, why it is important to be able to make sure that the country does not suffer from typhoons like, you know, like Odette. So we don't see any of the other candidates as offering a comprehensive program. In fact, hardly anybody else really offers a program for change. It's mainly, they're mainly running on personalities and images. And I think that's a very, very great disrespect for the people. When people run for office and only think about their program 30 minutes before an interview. Whereas what we said was that let's have two things in mind. One is we have to forge a program first and offer that to the people. And secondly, the record of Leody de Guzman and myself. We have been through the struggles and we've been on the streets. We've been in Congress. And we've consistently fought for the interests of people, and none of the other candidates can really offer that record, you know, of fighting for people's rights, as well as an unblemished record, you know, and people who are really, you know, what you might call non-politicians. In fact, we, you know, we dislike the kind of things that politicians stand for.
Here's the thing, though. I'm sorry to cut you there, Professor, but here's the thing. You had a chance in 2015 or even before that. You were on track as party list representative to further all these advocacies and to realize all these that you just mentioned. But you resigned from Congress as Akbayan representative due to conflicting views with then-President Aquino. So the question now is, how did your resignation help in furthering advocacies you've long fought for? And how can we be sure that you won't do the same thing again? That, you know, just because you differ views with someone, then you're just going to, as some called then, take the easy way out and just resign, Professor?
No, it was not the easy way out. It was a very difficult decisions. But, you know, if your party supports the president and you do not support as a party list representative, then there's only one way out in this instance, which is to let, you know, somebody else represent the party in Congress, because that party supports the president. I could no longer do that in all good conscience. So it was a very difficult position. If the party had been behind me, I would definitely have stayed on and fought on. But if you no longer represent the views of the party because the party decides to support the president and you no longer in good conscience do, then there's only one way out. Let somebody else take your place. So that was a very difficult decision on my part. And I think that I would say, Carmina, that that was also something that was an exemplary thing, like, you know, to be able to go, to be able to show the people that, you know, you resigned on a matter of principle. I think no other politician does that, or no other politician that I know has really done that in the history of the country.
Professor,
I think you just that people can, in fact, run on a politics of principle.
Professor, you've described the Philippines as being in a brave new world of politics under President Duterte. But is it really just politics of faith that brought him to power? What do you think, and very quickly now, was the contribution of the liberals and the left in paving the way for his rise to power?
Well, as I said earlier, there was a really great disappointment with, you know, the results of the EDSA years, those 30 years of EDSA, because I think there was a gap between the promises of 1986 and the results of 1986. Mm. And, you know, there were those of us who basically were saying, hey, you know, we really have, you know, you really have to deliver real reform when it comes to the economy, when it comes to land reform, when it comes to political reform.
Yeah. And what about the left?
And that's it. That was, and I think that disappointment was part of the reason why Duterte was able to come to power.
Mm, and what about the left, the role that the left played in his rise to power?
Well, I don't think really that the left played a role in a significant way, because this was a time that I think that the different groups within the left were really, you know, having a period of, you know, discussion, sometimes even conflict among themselves about what was happening. So I would say that there were, however, certain sectors of the left that were urging the liberals, you know, to in fact enact real reforms in the country, and pointing out that if those did not happen, then people would really be disappointed. I certainly was part of that sector of the left that was urging real reform to take place.
You also, I'm sorry to cut you there, Professor, but in one tweet you also said that the idea of progressives playing second fiddle to the liberals must be discarded. What did you mean exactly when you said that?
Well, I am referring to the current situation internationally and nationally. Internationally, in the sense that socialists have in fact proven that they can come to power on their own programs, and the last a place where they just did this was in Chile. And that's what we're trying to prove in the Philippines, that socialists, the progressives like Leody and myself, can in fact have the opportunity to come to power and no longer have, you know, to be running on the tailcoats of liberals. I mean, this refers to the fact that some people have been basically telling us, hey, don't run anymore because you're just making it difficult for Vice President Leni Robredo to become president. And we're basically saying, no, we're going to run because we're running on a program, and we're not just running, you know, for ourselves or for, you know, on behalf of certain groups. We're running for the future of the country. We represent a program, and none of the others really represent a program for the future.
Let's talk about those others, Professor. You're up against a doctor, three veteran lawmakers, and a popular mayor. What do you have over them? Tell us, why does the country need you more than them?
The country needs us because we have, you know, a battle-tested program of 13 points addressing all the major problems of our country at this point in time. And it is a well-thought-out program that comes from experience. The second reason, I think, is because of our record. We have been on the streets. We have fought the good fight. You know, we have a record of really fighting for people's interests. And I don't think the other candidates have that. Mm-hmm. Either they are riddled with corruption, like the Dutertes and, you know, the Marcoses, or they've been in politics for too long and they're just politicking. Mm-hmm. And so I think that the record and the programs that we represent, you know, are what the country needs at this point in time. And they do not need people who have been so enmeshed in politics that they, you know, can't see what is in fact in the interests of the people. We're not enmeshed in politics.
All right.
We've been out on the streets and fighting both nationally and internationally, you know, for causes we believe are dear to the people. And I think people will see that.